It's life.
It's life. नमस्कार, गुड आफ्टरनून. आप सभी का पीआरएल का अमृत व्याख्यान में स्वागत है, अभिनंदन है. ए वेरी हार्टी वेलकम फ्रॉम मी अनिल भारद्वाज फॉर द पीआरएल का अमृत व्याख्यान. दिस इज द सेकेंड व्याख्यान ऑफ द 75 एपिसोड सीरीज ऑफ द व्याख्यान विच इज बीइंग ऑर्गेनाइज्ड as a part of the PRL's 75 years of legacy and history. The history in the area of fundamental physics and space sciences. Established in the year 1947 by father of Indian space program, Dr. Vikram Sarabhai, the PRL's Platinum Jubilee or PRL at 75 coincides with the India's 75 years of independence. So, it's a joint celebration of the development of science and technology in India, being organized by PRL under the banner of PRL Ka Amrit Vyakhyan. For the second PRL Ka Amrit Vyakhyan, we have today with us a very distinguished speaker, Dr. S. Somnath, Director of Vikram Sarabhai Space Center in Trivandrum. Let me also personally greet and welcome and introduce some of our distinguished panel members who are live on the WebEx, and I will request them to just wave their hands so that our colleagues who are watching us live on YouTube can recognize them. We were expecting to join Dr. Madhavan Nair. There is some issue with his joining here today, so he may be joining soon, but later. Right now, he is trying to join. We have with us Dr. Lalitambika, Director of Human Space Flight Program at ISRO headquarters. We have with us Dr. Sita, Director or former Director of Space Science Program Office at ISRO headquarters and currently at Raman Research Institute. We have Dr. K. Rajiv, Director of Space Research Laboratory in Trivandrum. You have to wave that, yes. We have Dr. Amit Kumar Patra, Director of NARL, that is National Atmospheric Research Laboratory in Tirupati. We have Dr. Surinder Singh, Director of Semiconductor Laboratory in Chandigarh. We have Dr. Prakash Chauhan, Director of Indian Institute of Remote Sensing in Dehradun. We also have other distinguished colleagues, Dr. A. Jayaraman, ISRO Chair Professor and former Director of NARL. And we have Dr. Padmanabh Joshi. Padmanabhji, you are there? I think he's joined with some other name, so I'm not able to distinguish him. And then, of course, we have our Dean of PRL, Professor Pallam Raju, the Chair of the Vyakhyan Committee, Professor Nandita Srivastava of PRL, as well as many other colleagues who have joined us live on the YouTube. So let me all welcome you for this vyakhyan. For coming to today's topic and the speaker, the topic of today's vyakhyan is Reaching the Sky, Indian Launch Vehicle. So why we have chosen this topic as well as Dr. Somnath? The answer is again very simple and straight. Dr. Somnath is chosen because today is 11th August and tomorrow is 12th of August, which is the birth anniversary of Dr. Vikram Sarabhai. And tomorrow is actually the 102nd Jayanti of Dr. Sarabhai. Somnath ji is the director of Vikram Sarabhai Space Center, the ISRO's biggest and the oldest center. And of course, it is the very keen interest of Dr. Sarabhai to make India self-reliant in rocket or in the launch vehicle community, so that we have our own capability of launching our own spacecrafts. And Dr. Somnath is the director of the launch center in Trivandrum. Tomorrow, early morning, is the launch of GSLV F10, carrying the US-03 mission. And Dr. Somnath is actually joining us from Shahr because he's busy with the countdown of the launch for tomorrow. And this will be also a big tribute on the birth anniversary of Dr. Sarabhai, that we will have the launch of the GSLV F10 tomorrow early morning at 5:43 a.m. So we wish all the best and all the success for tomorrow's morning launch. Coming to the topic of launch vehicle and his and my connection. So Somnath ji, as you all know, is a launch man. He launches spacecrafts or satellites, which contains scientific experiments called payloads. And they are meant for doing science or science observations. So his jobs get over after the launch, once the spacecraft is put into an orbit. And that is a time when we take over, and it is our job starts to operate the instrument, to operate the payload, to collect the data, to analyze the data, to interpret the data, bring out the science and do the publication. So when he is enjoying after the launch, we all get busy for doing our science. So this is the big connection between Somnath ji and scientific community of scientists like me and many of the colleagues who have joined us live on this panel. Let me formally introduce Dr. Somnath ji, who is otherwise, of course, no need of introduction, particularly for space science community as well as for the launch vehicle. Dr. Somnath, in full form, is Sridhara Panikkar Somnath, is an aerospace engineer and rocket technologist, known for his tremendous contributions in the area of launch vehicle, particularly launch vehicle system engineering, structural design and structural dynamics, pyrotechnics or pyrosystems, mechanism, and of course, the whole integration of the launch vehicle. He has 36 years of service in ISRO. 36 years, okay? Joining VSSC in 1985 and working in the PSLV project. He was a part of the first successful launch of PSLV, that was PSLV D2. And subsequently, he held many positions, including the director of Liquid Propulsion System Center, associate director of VSSC, project director of GSLV Mark III, and in particular, when it had the launch of this CARE mission, which was the first mission, which was a capsule recovery experiment, which is essentially required now for, you know, the human space program. And of course, he's the chief of different technologies, which includes propulsion, space ordnance, structure. He's actually a structure man. So his basic training is mechanical engineering. And after BTech, he has done MTech from Indian Institute of Sciences. And with a gold medal. So let me a little bit read about his biodata, just to make you appraised that with a strong background in design, development, and management of launch vehicle systems, he is presently serving as the chairman of the Management Council of the Launch Vehicle Programs, Capacity Building, and Human Space Flight Program called Gaganyaan, as well as steering the technology development and management across various ISRO centers. He's a fellow of Indian National Academy of Engineering, fellow of Aeronautical Society of India, fellow of Astronautical Society of India, and an elected academician of International Academy of Astronautics. Somnath ji has received many awards and honors, and I will not list of them except to tell you that this includes Outstanding Achievement Award of ISRO, and from many professional bodies in India, including the National Aeronautic Prize, honorary doctorates from various universities, and currently, he serves as one of the vice presidents of International Astronautical Federation in charge of the technical activities. I will now take little liberty from Somnath ji because of my association with him lasting now close to 28 years. And I will now introduce Somnath. Somnath. I hope many of my friends will now understand what I'm trying to say. So I will do a little bit of anatomy of his name. And sorry, Somnath ji, excuse me. So Soma means in Ayurveda, it refers to lunar energy, or otherwise known as cosmic plasma. Okay. It is a subtlest form of matter and makes up the essence of ojas, or we can say as essential element for requirement of energy. Soma is actually an ancient plant used to make soma, and you can derive the word somaras from there. And soma is also used for moon as its norms. As well as soma refers to Somvar, which is Monday. And nowadays, this is the Savan ka Somvars are going on. So many of the colleagues may be keeping their fast on Mondays. And in biological terms, we say that the body as distinct from soul, mind, and psyche. So soma has many meanings, and he's the Nath, means, you know, the father of the somas. And in Sanskrit, or Vedic Sanskrit, soma means distilled, or distilling basically, or extracting, you know, which in turn refers to either wine or toxic. So I must say that he really intoxicate with his caliber, with his personal touch, with his vast knowledge, and his foreseeable insight into engineering and technology. And if I look back into my direct association with Somnath ji, working together way back in 1998-99 as a part of the SGTG, I don't know whether Somnath ji remembers now, Space Generation Task Group, you know. And some of the colleagues who are sitting here in this panel was also member, including Dr. Sita, you know, that time. And we were all talking about ISRO's 25 years down the line in 90s. And we are making plan of what ISRO will be in 2020s, 2030s, and things like that. Many years later, we again had a big task, which was a part of the STG, a special task group of 50 ISRO DOS scientists and engineers. And now I think I can see Surendra, Jaramanji, Laltambika, and many others who are sitting on this panel were part of that STG, where we were given the challenge of learning new things, not only just the science and technology, but also social science, management, economics, law, rules, regulations of how things happens in space and the economics of space science. And I can tell you that Somnath ji is very good in economics, particularly economics of space science and rocket technology. And we will listen from him on his talk of how the ISRO has developed the launch vehicle capabilities, what we are doing at present, and what is the plan for the futures. So we all had excellent time with him when I was in BSRT, but we still continue to have excellent time with him whenever we get time. And with this few words, let me request Dr. Somnath to deliver his talk on reaching the sky, the Indian launch vehicle. Dr. Madhunar, are you there right now? Has he joined us?
No, he has not joined.
Not, he has not joined. Okay, fine. So, I will request Dr. Somnath to deliver his talk. His lecture.
Thank you, Dr. Anil. I hope I am audible.
Yes, you are very much.
Okay. Oh, so thank you for such a long and a very interesting introduction of me. I never realized that I have so many such meanings in my name. I take it with a lot of humility what you said about me. In my today's talk, I will straight away come because of the time, quite a bit of time has been lost in the early part of the program. So to make up that, I need to rush through whatever I have prepared, so that we'll have some time to discuss and then clarify some questions, if at all any, from the members. The topic today is reaching the sky Indian launch vehicles, and many of my friends who are joined here directly and those who are observing this program know quite a bit about it. So I won't go into those statistics of what has been accomplished, but rather I would like to give an insight into what we are trying to do new and what is there in store for future and what directions we should look at. I think this is what is going to be the stress of my talk. So let me try to show the slide. Hopefully it comes.
Yes, I can see it.
Okay, yes. Okay. So let me start with a tribute to Dr. Sarabhai on his anniversary, as Dr. Anil has already mentioned about him. The Indian space program was driven by the vision of Dr. Vikram Sarabhai, and tomorrow being the 102, the birth anniversary of Sarabhai, we salute him for all his contributions, because it is through the vision of Sarabhai and also the structured approach later by Professor Dhawan that we have the launch vehicle program and spacecraft program that we have today. So it is my privilege to be on this occasion, to be with you, along with you, to salutations for his birth anniversary, which is going to be celebrated tomorrow. See, if you look at some of the old pictures that I collected from my archive in VSSC to look at the beginning of the rocket development here, I come across these photos. Some of them are very important photos. The Sarabhai, along with the great visionary standing there, all of them you know, so I won't introduce all of them. One of them left us in a few days back, who was a very important partner in building up the capability all across this place. So they were looking at the barren place locations, both at Vikram Sarabhai Space Center as well as at Satish Dhawan Space Center, in building those infrastructure that we enjoy today as the supports our program. But what I want to tell about is the launch that took place on 21st November 1963 with a payload of 20 kilograms, with a rocket which was brought from US, the Nike Apache rocket, and it went up to 200 kilometers. So this was the beginning of the rocket era in India. By the way Sarabhai could handle that, he could bring all those rockets, the equipment, the ground infrastructure, everything from the fighting colleagues. It was a Cold War going on, but through his influence, he was able to bring not so very friendly peoples to contribute to our nation's capability development. That was the charm that he enjoyed at that time. So this is very, very important set of information or photographs that I would like to share. The next step was, of course, building the sounding rockets of ISRO in the church building. Many of them were developed, early working place. And a series of sounding rockets were really built, because this was a time when rockets were used for scientific exploration, measurements in the atmosphere. The capability for science, instrumentation, measurements also got developed along with it. The Turles range got dedicated to UN. And from the 200 diameter, heavier sounding rockets were developed, having ability to go up to even 500 kilometers plus. So that legacy of building those sounding rockets, launching them, continues even today. Today, even at 11, say maybe around 12 o'clock today also, one of the sounding rockets was launched from Tumba Equatorial Rocket Launch Station. So I got the message, though I was here. It happened as a routine. Every month we launch these sounding rockets to support the scientific community. So I want to tell that the technology of rockets started here, but these were not able to put place satellite in orbit. They were just going up in the sky, then fall back to the Earth after conducting those experiments or measurements. So at this point of time, let me once again bring back the memories of Satish Dhawan, whom I say the integrator, for his vision on seeing the potential of the technologies that has been seeded by Sarabhai in Vikram Sarabhai Space Center and other places. He envisioned that it is possible to convert all these technologies, bring them together to build a rocket which will place a satellite in orbit. So these are picked from some of these pictures, which I am showing here, are picked from his seminal paper, Space Launchers for India. He has written, while these rockets were not yet developed, he envisioned that the PSLV series, the GSLV series, the INSAT series of satellites will be built by us, and also configured some sketches of how these rockets will look like in the future. So we will see some of these sketches becoming reality and being launched much later. So it is the vision of Satish Dhawan in identifying the potential of the research work that was been randomly seeded by Sarabhai, nurtured within the organization to convert it into a launch vehicle program. That ultimately it was SLV3. So the story of SLV3 began from there. So if you look at the evolution of satellite launch vehicle programs, SLV3 was conceived based on some of the existing designs elsewhere. We actually borrowed quite a bit from those arrangement or concept or engineering of the rocket. It was an all solid rocket with a lift off mass of 17 ton, capable of placing only around 40 kilogram of satellite. But it still had liquid propulsion capability in terms of control thrusters that did the attitude control. And the whole launch vehicle was designed to place small satellites in low Earth orbit missions. So SLV-3 was the beginning, and the story of SLV-3 is well read, well known all across the country and even the globe, how this capability was developed in this nation. What is more important is to me is after this capability of launch vehicle was achieved, we went on to develop the augmented satellite launch vehicle with the strap-ons, and the capability of the payload capability was enhanced to 150 kilogram. But the important element here is the true elements of a complex launch vehicle technology was brought into ASLV. Various technologies, it includes strap-on technology, the strap-down inertial navigation systems, the bulbous heat shield, various algorithms that went into the staging and optimization and so on and so forth. Various elements of technology that go into the launch vehicle were tested and tried out in ASLV. So that is the milestone in the development of launch vehicle program. But the ASLV program was not a very smooth ride at all. They were faced with many failures. And this was a time when I joined ISRO. So when I joined, the few days of my joining, there was or few months of my joining, the launches of ASLV was taking place. We were hearing the failures, and some of these pictures which you are seeing were also, I had the fortune to see them, and we were all worried about it, and we were not very sure about our prospects in ISRO as engineers, whether are we working on very successful technology, or we are really being scolded by the public in terms of our ability to place satellites in orbit. We were not very sure about it. And remind you that I was in a project called PSLV. At that time, the PSLV was still in picture, some drawings, some sketches, whereas the ASLV was still not successful. So just imagine that plight of us in understanding the launch vehicle technology, building them, and talking about 1,000 kilogram satellites when we are finding it difficult to place a 150 kilogram satellite in a low Earth orbit. So, but the nobody lost heart at this time. They were trying to understand. And even in my younger age, I remember trying to understand what our failure analysis committee at that time brought out and how launch vehicles need to be controlled, realized, how to handle the transitions from one stage to another, how to understand the interaction between structures and aerodynamics and control. In fact, I tell you, my M.Tech, when I decided that I will study this domain, this topic, how control structure interactions and how it is important to us. So I decided that I will study that. And in fact, I could study in when I went for my master's, though I couldn't really use in a real program because by the time people in VSSC were already masters in it. My skill was not necessary. So, but I want to tell here is that this was a learning period in the launch vehicle technology, in understanding how the very, very intricate elements of rockets are to be understood in successfully placing satellites in orbit. So today we have PSLV. The PSLV is the real workhorse of the launch vehicle. It has done 50 plus missions successfully. It has gone to all orbits. So just remember that when this PSLV project was conceived, it was only for placing satellites in polar synchronous orbit because it was the necessity at that point of time to look at the remote sensing 1,000 kilogram satellite to 1,000 kilometer orbit. But later, it was used for the low Earth orbit missions, GTO missions, scientific missions, especially the Chandrayaan 1 and Mars orbiter missions, really remarkable. But later, in my time, in when I was in PSLV, I had a passion to this rocket because I have touched almost every part of this rocket in its early part of the mission, and I could develop certain elements in this rockets along with those giants. Dr. Maran Nair was a project director at that time. So it was such a fortune to learn the rocket at that time. Today, PSLE has so many varieties, variants, XL, DL, C, and QL, and Core alone versions to meeting various mission and payload capability. And it's one of the cost-effective and highly reliable sought-after launch vehicle. And PSLE can have various payload combinations, either single satellite or multiple satellites. Probably many of you know how it launched 104 satellites in one go, created a history. So all this engineering of these multiple satellites and then dispensing them with so much of success is really remarkable. And I was fortunate to develop the very first satellite, commercial satellite launch capability in PSLV, successfully did in C4 missions. So that was my contribution at that point of time. So later, almost 300 plus satellites, commercial satellites, could be launched using PSLV. I only want to show you this certificate issued by none other than Dr. Madhav Naya to the team Chandrayaan 1 for making this mission possible using PSLV. Really, it is a wonderful thing to happen. A launch vehicle which was never thought that it can really do such a mission. The payload is very restricted. We were trying our best to increase and enhance the capability of the vehicle to meet the Chandrayaan 1 capability, and that too achieved with great under very tough situations. And finally, we could achieve the moon impact probe and a launch, and also accomplish one of the important scientific finding of finding the hydroxyl molecules on the surface of the moon. Really remarkable thing. And especially the certificate is so important, being signed by one of the Indian presidents of this International Academy of Astronautics. Coming to the GSLV, the GSLV has now become an operational launcher. Now it has successful missions in series, and it has established its reliability and versatility and enhanced the payload capability also. So as already mentioned, tomorrow we have the launch of GSLV F10 EOI-03 mission at 5:43 hours. Of course, you know the criticality of any launch, and we keep our hands closed, and we prayed so that this launch also becomes successful, as we have seen in earlier missions, because it is so important that what very, very important satellite is on board, which will give you such a observation capability for the entire country from a vantage position in space. The importance of GSLV is not, it is yet another rocket, but it actually created the capability because of the core technology in this rocket is nothing other than the cryogenics. So I will discuss some of the technology elements of rockets a little later. We traveled in great difficult times in understanding the cryogenic technology. It took almost 20 years plus to master this, build the first of the cryogenic engine and put it in GSLV. But once we have accomplished the success in second of the flight, then we were successful throughout. And later, though this engine was the Russian engine, we could re-engineer and make it in India. But we later in GSLV Mark 3, we could build our own cryogenic engine. And the mastery that we have in cryogenics is really unparalleled, I think I must say that. So I just showed you these three pictures of rocket of GSLV being launched using our own cryogenics engine and stage. Coming to GSLV Mark 3, I was a part of the GSLV Mark 3 team ever since its beginning, and was there till the GSLV X mission with a passive cryogenic stage and the crew module was launched. It was a suborbital mission. And in the GSLV Mark 3 D1 mission, I was at LPSC. We were working to make the cryogenic engine develop and completed and then put in this rocket. And really, really wonderful thing to happen that in the very first mission of the cryogenic engine, which is a totally different thermodynamic cycle, yet a totally new engine, not the one which is re-engineering of the Russian stage, not at all it is. But this engine was very, very successful in its very first flight and subsequent flights till the last one. So even in its development, it didn't face any serious issues of technologies. So that is a real mastery that we achieved in this cryogenic technology. So today we have, starting from the sounding rockets, way up to the GSLV Mark 3 with a payload capability of 4.2 tons to GTO. And we are looking at future on how this launch vehicle generations are really going to evolve in the coming days. So this is the topic which I am going to cover in my subsequent slides. I hope I am not going too fast. So let me talk a bit about the technology spread of rocket. So we all use the terminology called rocket science. So rocket science is something not very easily understood. But as you know, that rocket technology is really complex one. It has all elements of engineering and sciences into it. the most important part of this is each one on its own are not very complex, but the real complexity in rocket is that the interplay between many of them, which I mentioned earlier, the interaction between control and structures, the control and propulsion, aerodynamics and propulsion, thermal and propulsion, mechanisms, sequencing, avionics and sensors. So there is a host of understanding required among them. So it's very difficult to convey this to you in one slide. So because I am really understanding this, when a new agency, so there, you are aware there are startups trying to develop rockets outside. When they start developing, really, really the struggle they go through in the absence of the knowledge, we can understand how much really tacit knowledge we are having internal to the system. The people here, now we are able to design and develop a propulsion system within no time. It is simply because the type of knowledge that we accrued over the years, through the generations, through the failures and hits and misses. This is very, very important. So if I explain each one of them, it really, really will take 1 hour to explain each of these titles, so I won't venture on that. The propulsion is the key, which I will explain later, various types of propulsion, and equally important is understanding the mission. Because rocket is such a machine that it is working on razor edge margins. So when from the launch to the injection, it has to travel a precise path, meeting various constraints. You know, an optimization problem, how an optimization problem is to be conceived, how to achieve it without breaking down into pieces the rocket. This is the whole crux of the problem. And I will just show you one or two slides on learning part that has really been accomplished in understanding it and various other technologies that goes into building rockets. So many people really don't understand. So rocket is all hardware. It looks just like a hardware. What is the big deal in it? So this is always, I hear this question. Once you make one PSLV, another PSLV is yet another PSLV, but it's not really true. Please understand that it's really a multidisciplinary domain expertise. And I don't believe that one expert will really understand the other expert. So in the organization, what you have generated or created are people who will really understand so many people and the interplay between them. So this is the real crux of the engineering is. Each one is very good in each of the designs. Some of them are very good in mission design. Some of them are really good in electronics. Some are really good in structural design. But who is really understanding each other without really not having so much of ego? Yeah, I am the best of it. These were the really real problems in the organization long back. And these problems were solved by Dhawan. I think that's why in this organization, we are able to build such complex systems without any real issue. So one lesson, I will tell you, one historical lesson from trajectory optimization. So this was in 1973 when Professor S.K. Srivastava, maybe some of you may know, he is a famous professor at Indian Institute of Science who taught many of the earlier colleagues, seniors in this organization. They were talking about the optimization SLV-3. He said that it is possible to gain almost 100% more payload in SLV-3 by optimization. And this was a time when Kalam intervened and he started studying it through formal method. There was not even a formal method to understand what is the real payload of a rocket. Just imagine. If you do an optimal trajectory, you will be able to get almost double. Somebody says there was no way to even defend that. But later, there were tools were developed, software were developed, algorithms were developed, and they proved that the payload capabilities, SLV-3 was just the same as 40 kilogram only. So, but today, nobody asks such a question because there are formal tools and methods available to understand what really a payload capability of a rocket using all constraints satisfied. So this is from a reference of a book article written by Dr. V. Adimurthy. He is well known for his capabilities in trajectory optimization. Yet another important finding from launch vehicle is how do you really optimize? You know, rocket starts vertically standing on a launch pedestal, but ultimately it has to inject satellites giving the maximum velocity in the horizontal direction. So start almost 90 degree plus turning it has to do and just reach orbit, converting entire energy of the rocket into horizontal velocity, whereas it starts vertically. So this trajectory change of direction from vertical to horizontal is done in such a precise manner that we at every point in the trajectory, we meet various constraints and convert entire energy, the chemical energy, into the inertial velocity of the satellite, the most optimum manner. It calls for understanding the mechanics and the dynamics of the interaction with the atmosphere, loads, the optimization problem. We need to model the entire rocket in mathematical domain and solve this complex mathematical optimization problem. And also look at how we contain the control demand, contain the loads in a very safe manner. This The problem is what is addressed as a trajectory optimization problem. Even this got developed. It's continuing to develop in this organization. Let us also understand that propulsion, the rocket engine, is too much powerful, really. You compare with the most, one of the very powerful engines on road. See, take the F1 engine, which runs on the super fast tracks, which has 735 kilowatt of power, almost 1000 HP. But if you compare the space shuttle main engine, which weighs only 350 kilogram, it has a power of 71,000 horsepower, almost 54 megawatt of power put in just 350 kilogram. So the power density of a rocket engine is too high. So this is the crux of the problem of designing of the rocket. So though in a very small mass, you pack so much of energy, and how to deliver this energy in a controlled manner is the essence of rocket engineering. So if you look at the propulsion system across, we see chemical rockets. Ultimately, the energy comes from chemical rockets, combustioning fuel and oxidizer in various forms, in liquids, gaseous form, monopropellant, bipropellant, cryogenics, hypergolic, we call all of them. Today in ISRO, we have grip on any of these propulsion technologies. You would say as rockets, we have all types of rocket fuels and also liquids of various types. And we are developing new ones. We are developing kerosene-based, we are developing hydrogen peroxide-based, new thrusters, green propellants, all of these are coming. And we have created testing and evaluation facilities across centers. Solid motors. Starting from very, very small motor we used in Chandrayaan 1, a very small one for the spin rocket of the moon impact probe with the zero aluminum content, to the huge rockets S-200 with the propellant mass of, loading of almost 200 tons. We could make it in ISRO today, in total internally, and the very first time they become successful. And this is a real mastery that we have in solid motors. The solid motor, though it looks very simple, it's a very complex system. And I can tell you that the failures in the earlier days, if you really analyze, you will understand that today people are able to engineer rocket solid motors so well is because of those failures that we faced. One example I want to tell you, PSLV, the third stage motor, it was failing test after test. It was not successful in the very first test, 3 or 4 tests, and people were becoming impatient. How do we really, this PSLV program will take off, the composite motor? And today, we are developing composite motors just like that, and they are becoming successful in the very first test. We have recently done for SSLV. Both of the tests are successful, very first go. How it happened? It just doesn't happen. The structure.
Hello?
Interruption there.
I think there's an interruption from their side. Are you back? Dr. Somnath?
Can I continue? Yes.
Yeah, there was a small interruption in between, so probably you need to go back to the previous slide that starts from there.
Can I?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Yeah, I was talking about the technologies associated with the solid motor processing. The solid rocket, it's just like a very simple system that propellant is stored in the pressure chamber, and we are the exhaust of the plume comes through the nozzle and gives the thrust. It's not a simple thing like that. It actually encompasses various technologies, right, from the motor cases to the thermal design, to the propellant strain grain design, its structural margins, its life, chemical processes involved in this, and host of them. And we were not successful in the very beginning to start with in the solid motor area. Even in the PSLV, when we started the third stage motor, the one of the best motor in the world, third stage, we call it HPS3. Best in the sense that it has the highest propellant loading fraction. That is, out of the total mass, the propellant mass is almost 89% or so. So that type of motor we could make after a series of failures. So today, when we enjoy the success in solid motor, is on account of all those failures that we faced at that time. Now, coming to liquid propulsion, this was the formative phase. 1969, really, we started liquid propulsion systems. the understanding of the bipropellants, small rockets were developed at that time. And in 73, since 74, we developed the first 3-ton liquid engine. And even we did the test of a rocket in liquid engine. It's like what Goddard did at that time, or even Sikorsky did. Similar to that, we did experiments in on liquid engines at Tumba. But somehow these activities in liquid propulsion was not taken up seriously until we really felt the need of a liquid rocket in PSLV. So that was a turning point. Quite a bit of work. I am not going through the historical aspect of the development of liquid engines. We even developed even cryogenic engines. Cryogenic propulsion systems were installed in 1970s in ISRO, but we never taken it forward. But really the change happened when we went to a collaborative work in developing the Vikas engine, the Viking engine, along with the French. And through that process, we understood quite a bit on how to make a high thrust liquid engine. Today, we have so many liquid engines for right starting at 735 kilonewton Vikas engine to the satellite engine, the upper stage engines, and so many types of control thrusters, including all the engines our satellites are carrying today. Even the Chandrayaan engine, which is an 800 Newton engine, recently developed throttleable engine, it's also our own engine. It's not a technology that we borrowed. So today, the liquid engine technology is one of the very strong area. Similarly, the cryogenic propulsion. The cryogenic propulsion, though we started in 70s, I said that it didn't take off very well. The real turning point was in going to the Cloud Cosmos, Russia, trying to understand, get the technology from them. Later, it didn't materialize. We brought certain stages of cryogenic engine. Using that, we launched GSLV. But we started learning this process slowly, and we involved with the Russians to understand this, and we could ultimately develop this engine ourselves. When I say this one statement that we developed it ourselves, I think it doesn't convey the whole of the meaning. The technology element in this rocket was quite huge. That involves materials, manufacturing technologies, the combustion and thermal technologies, the starting of an engine and its sequence. Even the sequence development was really complex. The safety associated with it, and so many facilities came up to understand this cryogenic technology. So I had the fortune to work in LPSC and then be part of this C-25, CE-20 engine development, understood the intricacies of this. I can tell you it's really beautiful, massive, complex, machine it is, a cryogenic engine. You need to understand every nut and bolt of it, otherwise it will fail. So it's such a beautiful thing, such a powerhouse. And the criticality here is that you are dealing with very low temperature at one end and almost 3000 Kelvin at the other end. And you are separating it by just certain flow passages, these two temperatures. And materials have to sustain its strength and working at 20 Kelvin as well as at 3000 Kelvin at the same time. So it works for such a short time and delivers huge power. This engine, the power is almost 3 megawatt in a mass of just half a ton. So just I'm trying to show you one turbo pump that you would have seen pumps, water pumps and similar pumps. Just look at one of the pump, which is very 3 megawatt thing. This I can lift with my hand, but it develops 3 megawatt of power. And the internal flow paths and systems and ceilings and bearings and turbo machinery and materials. And it makes life really difficult to achieve such a perfection in realizing some of the components of engine. So liquid propulsion engines at stage, we have an array of them, starting from the semi-cryogenic engine we are developing up to the electric propulsion thruster, which gives maybe even 300 millinewton of thrust. So a series of them are being developed and deployed for our launch vehicle program. This I mentioned about the propulsion technology, but there are so many technologies. I am taking just one example of materials technology. This is one of the strength of Vikas Aerospace Space Center. Any material that you want to build rockets or spacecrafts, you can simply contact Vikas Aerospace Space Center. They will make it and deliver. This is the type of assurance I can tell you. See, way back in 1970s, there was a need felt for developing one of the super strong steels called maraging steel. And without this maraging steel, PSLV was simply not possible. Even today, this steel is not there. PSLV can never be designed, realized, and launched. It will not give any payload. So this technology of developing this maraging steel was indigenously accomplished and realized through Indian industries. It was first melted and made within VSSC, then transferred to Midani, using Rourkela steel plant and various facilities all across the country. This steel is currently one of the best steel of Maharajan Steels in the world, we can say, which is surviving the test of time. So let me look at what is in store for us in the future. So we know that the type of satellites which are being launched, the type of the market demand is slowly changing, and we were looking at what is the demand type of rocket for the launchers for small satellites, which are now really increasing in numbers. Thousands of them are getting launched, and their demand for launch cannot be yearly. It will be just few weeks that they want to launch. And can we make a rocket which is going to meet such a demand? And the question was raised, and we came out with the answer: yes, we will develop a solid-based rocket, but of course with a liquid upper stage, which will do the trimming and precise injection. And this rocket can be made ready, and we can be launched within very short time, and the cost also will be substantially lower. I won't tell you the cost here because it is really low. So, and we are able to produce this very, very fast. Typically, we take about 10 years to develop a rocket, but this rocket was developed in just 1.5 years. And we are now getting ready for the first launch. Because without COVID, I think we would have been even launched by now. So this is called small satellite launch vehicle. And after 1 or 2 launches, it will go to industry. And this will be launching, I am sure, most of the small satellites this country is producing, and will have quite a bit of market outside as well. Another interesting work that we are doing is on the reusable launch vehicle. Of course, the space shuttle has been shelved, but probably you know that in the world over, interest in winged rocket has not diminished. Even now, people are working on them, and various technologies are being tried. And we have an approved program today called Orbital Recovery Vehicle, ORV, which will go to orbit 400 kilometers and then come back and land in a strip. And we are currently working on, but its precursors of landing on landing strip and various other technologies are currently going on. So this is one interesting work which we are currently working on. We are also working on air breathing propulsion. Air breathing propulsion, you know, the day I joined ISRO, I have been hearing this air breathing propulsion. There was a team in ISRO working on air breathing propulsion, but they never succeeded. Because getting a combustion in a hypersonic flow, you can understand Mach 6, the type of velocities are involved in such a flow. In that flow, a stable combustion is really difficult. It is like they say lighting a matchstick in the in hurricane when it is blowing. So, but they have accomplished it this successfully in one of the test flights using a sounding rocket. Now we got approval to work on a still heavier and complex machine called the airframe integrated air breathing engine. Currently, the work is progressing, and we are trying to do this development test in another 1 year or so. Another interesting rocket we are developing is this heavy-headed one. This is called the test vehicle. Though we didn't give any fancy name to it because it is just a test vehicle. This is not a rocket that will go to place a satellite in orbit, but this will test the Gaganyaan mission crew module in its abort conditions. Because we can put a crew module in a regular rocket and then make the rocket fail and see what will happen next. So we made a rocket which will take the crew module up in the space, then make the vehicle terminate, then make the crew module escape, and then demonstrate how crew escape system can really function. This is a fully autonomous rocket by itself. So this is currently undergoing development. It is almost completed. The first flight vehicle is undergoing integration. So this will be the first of the Gaganyaan mission, not the real mission. So we'll be doing all abort type of missions first to prove the technology. Then we'll take the real crew up in the GSLV Mark-3. When this test vehicle is developed, we have another idea in mind. We wanted to test the vertical landing concept, because vertical landing concept is something very, very important. This was realized long back. Even while when I was youngster, we did some literature survey, as we said, in various committees of what Anil mentioned. We were proposing various technologies that need to be demonstrated, developed. It was so we were so eager to do that. Of course, we understand in our environment, in what we are working, investing on such a futuristic project is always faced with criticism, skepticism. Can we do it really? These questions are always asked. So of course, we didn't work on it till now, but I think it is a time for us to work on vertical landing concept. We have proposed that it will be based on the test vehicle configuration. We will do the vertical landing with a throttleable engine, And once you do that, then only we will really get the reusability, the cost effectiveness and affordability for a rocket, as has already been demonstrated by SpaceX and others. And we already discussed and worked out on all the technologies required for vertical landing. It involves throttleable engine, controlling the retropropulsion, also the vision navigation, and various other associated elements which I am not going through. We have teams currently working on this to showcase this demonstration, even landing legs and various other elements of this technology. We are working on them. I am sure this after the Gaganyaan mission, we will really get the Philip to go full steam on this so that this can really become part of the ISRO capability. Another interesting project we started is about the sounding rockets. We were having many sounding rockets. We have 560 Daya, we have 200 Daya, we have 100 Daya. And we asked a question, why don't we use this sounding rockets to make a launch vehicle? And we formulated a concept called a nanosatellite launch vehicle. Currently, all these rockets which are required are developed, but sounding rockets and launch vehicles are entirely different class of them. They need to be steered through a velocity change, which is from vertical to horizontal, I mentioned earlier. But this change of the concept, the reorientation strategy, while it is thrusting, it needs to reorient. And this is the crux of the problem. And we have even addressed this and developed certain solid propellant-based control system to enable nanosatellite launch vehicle possible. But this rocket can launch just 5 kilograms of satellite, and I'm sure a 5 kilogram is going to be a huge mass for people like you, scientific community. I think we can build and put some experiments into it, very low-cost launcher. And this is something that we are currently working on. I'm sure we will be coming out with a successful mission soon. Yet another interesting work we are doing is a hybrid rocket. Hybrid rocket is like a liquid engine in a solid booster. So we use liquid oxygen as oxidizer and solid fuel in the rocket, and we can throttle it and control the thrust and achieve very precise missions. And currently the program is only up to a sounding rocket level, and this has a great potential in the future. As you know, some of you may be knowing that hybrid rockets are well used in various domains, especially in the military domain, where there is a need to throttle or increase thrust whenever it's needed. Human spaceflight Gaganyaan is yet another challenge for the launch vehicle community. It is not because rockets are going to be anything new, but the whole challenge is in making it extra reliable. Because it's not only the rocket has to be reliable, but we need to build in high levels of redundancy. Also, we have to build in intelligence into it. Now, rocket earlier, it was a mechanical engineer's domain, or now it is going to be computer scientist and electronics fellows domain in a big way, much bigger way. And they are going to decide when the rocket has to be destroyed on board. Even that intelligence is not even given to any rocket still so far. It is all decided in ground by somebody. Now it has to be transferred. The responsibility has to be transferred to the rocket to make those choices. And we are working on such a system called vehicle health management system, which will look at the rocket health. We'll run a model of the rocket internally, compare the actual flight with the model flight internally in computer, and see whether there is a perturbation going on. And based on the extent of perturbation, decision will be taken to abort the mission and go for crew escape. So the GSLA Mar 3, which is chosen vehicle for it, is currently being re-engineered. It has, and most of the work is in electronics and algorithms and sensors, and also building higher levels of reliability on mechanical and propulsion system as well. So it encompasses electronics, control systems, pyros in terms of extended reliabilities. Because electronics and computers and softwares are become so handy, and people, all of us understand it now better than earlier times, it is possible to do these type of things in much more intelligence can be brought into rockets from earlier times. So let me go to the future launch vehicles, what is the need and approach. Okay, some of the concluding slides now. Now, if you look at the evolution of rockets, I find that they are in different classes. They are into a heavy class. There may be a future super heavy class. We have the medium class, which I say up to GSLA Mar 3, and the small ones, the SSLV and all that. What we have managerially decided in VSSC or ISRO is that the medium and small class, which are going to be more of operational nature, must go out of this organization to the industry. And they should be able to produce and launch and meet all the demands of the customers. Whereas the future required for human spaceflight, going for interplanetary missions, building space stations, they need to be sustained within the organization, which is to be funded separately, and then we need to build on this capability, because people will not come up to build this, you know, in private domain in big way, because the commercial prospects are lower. So this type of demarcation need to be done in the long term. But at the same time, we should not forget about the technologies. So like the air breathing propulsion, the reusable launch vehicles, etc. We will not find takers in the commercial domain immediately. So this also need to be sustained within the organization. This is a management approach to the rocket development. We probably, some of you may know that we are developing a huge semi-cryogenic engine in LPSC. It's a 200-ton engine. Currently, the development is going on. It has reached certain milestones now. And when this engine is available, our payload capability will grow and we will be able to cluster them and increase our payload capability substantially. So I'm just showing few slides when this engine becomes a reality. It is going to be a green propulsion, because compared to the UDMH N2O4 combination that we have today, we will have kerosene and liquid oxygen, and the stage will have huge thrust. So it suits the booster stages of a rocket. So look at the GSLV Mark III. We have already done up to M1 mission. That's called the operational mission, which Chandrayaan 2 was launched. We are waiting for the M2, M3, M4, M5 missions of GSLV Mark III. And we are currently plans to induct the semi-cryo stage into the M4 mission, thus increasing the payload capability to almost 6 tons. So this is one path that we want to take for enhancing our capability in the coming years. Yet another approach is to look at how we will develop a heavy lift launcher. This HLV is just a name, is a generic name. We might give it specific names in the days to come, but it will be mostly a liquid dominated rocket, because liquid engines like the semi cryogenic engine will become the booster. The cryogenic stages will be the upper stage. Sometimes we may add solid boosters like the one which is shown on the last, called SHLV, so that the payload capability can be as much as 30 tons to low Earth orbit. So with this capability, we can build space stations of our own. So something like 8-ton reusable launch vehicle it will be. So this is the biggest rocket that we can develop with the current known technology that ISRO has. And I'm sure this is easily achievable today. If you have the desire, the money, and approval from government, ISRO can do it without any difficulty. Another technology which we need to develop is the vertical landing and capability. As I mentioned earlier, the test vehicle will fly for Gaganyaan, and test vehicle will be modified to demonstrate the vertical takeoff and landing capability, and will also demonstrate the air breathing engine test flight demonstration. So this chain of development is really triggered by the test vehicle we have engineered for the crew escape system demonstration. So when we identify this potential, all this were brought into the future ideas into the engineering of the rocket already. Yet another stream is called the reusable launch vehicle with a winged rocket. As I mentioned, currently we are in the first part of it. We are trying to do the helicopter drop test in a runway and demonstrate the landing autonomously. We will be also looking at flying it on top of GSLV or to orbit and bring back. And way down the line, in around 2030, we would like to put it on top of the semi-cryo stage, a much heavier TSTO vehicle, which will have at least a few tons, something like 10 tons to low Earth orbit capability. So this is the road map for reusable launch vehicle development that we have in mind. And none of these are human flight capable. They are all autonomous robotic capability. Air breathing engines, as I mentioned earlier, we also have a roadmap for it. Currently, we are working on a new project called HAWA. HAWA is a hypersonic air vehicle with an airframe integrated system, which I shown earlier. There, we will fly this engine with a kerosene propellant, and for a very long time, something like 300 seconds duration, and we will be able to show the scramjet engine. And we want to integrate this engine underneath a regular ARLV and then show that we can have a supersonic, hypersonic flight. And then the vehicle will come and land in the runways, thus by reusing the hardware most of the time and bring down the cost of launching. So this is a conceptual drawing of such a vehicle, and this detailed engineering of it is not done, but this is just a concept, how such a full two-stage to orbit vehicle can really be possible. And I want to tell you, these are not just ideas. These are concepts that are feasible. And we had a great amount of discussion with Boeing recently on this such a vehicle, and they are looking for cryogenic engine of ours to be supplied. In fact, we went up to a contract signing on such a vehicle development along with Boeing. So Let me conclude with some slides on the vision and approach. So I summarized the whole of the long-term plan in some two slides to show that we are working on enabling technologies like the future heavy thrust engine, clustering, also working on low-cost access to space by injecting air-breathing propulsion. We are working on the human space flight capability. And finally, those capabilities will drive to a very high reliable human space flight missions vehicle. Also, we will not forget the regular rocket like the PSLV, GSLV, or GSLA Mark 3. They continue to serve our segments of satellites which we have today, because PSLV is very cost effective one, very reliable one. It's not very worth to discontinue when other vehicles are there. So we need to continue all of them, but make progresses in developing future vehicles based on the technology which we have collected so far. Maybe at some point of time, we need to retire some of these rockets. That decision will be taken appropriately. So I believe with this capability, it will be possible to develop rockets capable of launching almost 30 tons to low Earth orbit. And that should be good enough for our future missions that we have in mind. But to acquire that technology, there are various technological elements, which includes propulsion area, materials area, design and fabrication, and various other technologies. We are addressing all of them. In this country, currently the engineering capability in this country has really enhanced substantially in the private sector in terms of manufacturing huge rocket parts. Probably some of you may be knowing that propellant tanks are coming from industries today, and new technologies are coming into the manufacturing domain, including composites. And we are also good at in new electronics development, but still there are deficiencies in the area of composite materials, high reliable electronics, etc., etc. So keeping them there, we continue to work on new technologies to enable this growth in launch vehicle possible. Today, we are almost 80% in industry. We are producing all the rocket, almost 80% of the rocket is made in industry. And with this capability, we are even proposing that PSLV should go to industry. And the industry consortium has been already tendered, and we are working on how to transfer even PSLV production and launch to an industry. This is yet another managerial decision that we have taken, and we are working for such a change to take place so that we can take up the new developments of heavy thrust rocket, etc. Otherwise, organization will be choked we will not be in a position to do in the future developments. While we worked on rockets, and it is very equally important to build the capability in India to launch them. I only want to show you that in Sriharikota, where I am today, the capabilities in building the infrastructure to launch them, process them, integrate them, and has been really enhanced. You must come here and see and watch the type of building or facilities that are coming up in Satish Dhawan Space Center, the spaceport of India, where we build the solid boosters and we integrate the rockets and service the rockets and launch them. Even the first launch pad where we started the PSLV is really getting augmented to launch almost 10 launches per year. So this is the type of capability that you are developing in the organization to serve the launch vehicle requirements and to meet finally the placing of all the satellites that we have today. So with that, let me conclude my talk and my greetings to all of you from Vikrasarabhai Space Center on the eve of birth center celebration of Dr. Vikram Sarabhai tomorrow, which is coinciding with the launch of GSLV F10. And I seek all your blessings for the successful launch of GSLV. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Somnath, for an excellent talk. Actually, starting from the basics and then going into complexities of the launch vehicle and how did we master the technologies, the whole complicated technologies, what we call as rocket science, and then the different difficulties which have come across during this development. And then taking us into future about the new technologies which is getting developed within the country, within Israel, whether it's RLV, the reusable material, hybrid rockets, the Gaganyaan mission, the vertical landings, the small satellite launch vehicle, or the nano satellite launch vehicle, which is of course going to be very useful for scientists like us. We want to fly small satellites, rather than a very big satellite. And of course, going into semi-cryogenics and then AVA, where we do this air breathing and so excellent talk. And I hope all of our audience must have been really thrilled and understood much in much better way. I would now request Dr. Santosh Vadavale and Dr. Shanmukham to conduct the question answer session by asking from the chat box in the YouTube as well as on the panel which is present live. Dr. Santosh?
Yeah. Thank you very much, Professor Bharadwaj, and thank you, Somnath sir, for such an exciting talk. I mean, many of us are sort of aware about various launch vehicle programs of ISRO, but some of the details in technology which you provided today, I mean, we cannot expect anywhere from anywhere else except from you. So it was really, really thrilling to listen to all these aspects. There are some questions. I will start with one question which you have already answered, but since it has been asked, I will just repeat it. The question was, does ISRO have any plan to design a reusable rocket like SpaceX Falcon 9, which you have already mentioned that yes, ISRO is working on it. Another question is, what type of rocket can be used for sample return mission from Moon? So, you know, there are such plans. So which of the vehicles which can be used for such a mission?
Okay, essentially the sample return mission requires a restartable propulsion system that the lander craft has to come back. Basically, once you are landed in Moon, then you need to take off from there. Wherever you have landed, it becomes a launch pad for the satellite. You have to take off from there, reach an orbit. Then from the Moon orbit, you need to start the return path by giving additional velocity. And then when you reach back to the Earth's gravity field, you need to come back and then re-enter through atmosphere. The same craft cannot enter because the re-entry craft will be entirely different design, which has to withstand the thermal environment. And it has to meet the re-entry conditions like a typical crew module as we have. And it can command land through parachute systems or a drop propulsion. So essentially, a sample return is similar to what we have, what the Apollo probably has done. In much smaller scale, if the sample alone is coming back, of course it can be much smaller and the corresponding propulsion system can be much lighter. But in the rocket side, I think there may not be any significant change because it's ultimately putting the whole of this engineered item into a Earth-bound orbit, beyond which it is a spacecraft's propulsion that will take you to the Moon, land and come back. So the entire part of that will be mostly a spacecraft, but the propulsion system, of course, will become integral part of it. So here the essence of this is well understood. I think once we have demonstrated the landing on the Moon, we can discuss how to take off from that point and then come back to Earth. Of course, that is possible.
Yeah, thank you, sir. So one more question is about a possibility of participation of small R&D companies in ISRO. I mean, what kind of role the small R&D companies can make? I mean, you mentioned about taking up a full launch vehicle fabrication integration, but are there any possibilities for lower level R&D?
No, when you talk about R&D, we need to be very, very specific. What type of R&D you are looking at it? In terms of rocket design, development and engineering, currently there is the required R&D capability exists within ISRO. But if you look at a very novel technologies, for example, you would look at electric propulsion. We have even looked at startups and new companies to start this program. We have even funded seed money from ISRO to develop. One of them is a startup company in Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, and they are developing on RF plasma thruster. And they have done a prototyping of it, and we have said that once they demonstrate it, we will be engineering it to put in one of the satellites. They use water as a propellant, this is one area. Suppose somebody would like to work on an electronics device, for example, a new navigation computer. They want to develop based on an indigenous processor. We can invite that idea into us. Suppose they look at a composite item that can be developed, which is a totally different way than what we do. It has an interest. We have an interest in working on it. We have a lot of R&D work in terms of materials development, process development. One example which we have recently found out is to use bacteria to decompose the propellant, which is left out, for example. We were finding it is very, very polluting. This ammonium perchlorate of the solid propellant is very polluting. And the only way to dispose it off is by burning. And it is again producing hydrochloric acid and chlorine products. So we we contacted IMTech, which is a CSIR lab, which decomposes these chemicals using a bacteria group. And they were successful recently, and we ended up in a contract with them to scale up and build huge facilities by which this can be decomposed and destroyed. So like that, we are looking at technologies where we are not working on, where it will be possible to contribute to our program.
Yeah, thank you, sir. So I think this will give a very good inputs to the people who are looking to join some efforts with ISRO R&D programs. There's one more question on the related side. Are there any... Okay.
I would like to seek your permission to leave because Chairman ISRO is already here and he is asking me to join for a review. Can I leave?
Yeah, okay, sir. So
can you spend another 2 minutes? We'll just wind up.
Okay.
Okay, so...
May I request Dr. Pallam Raju? You are muted. You are muted. You have to unmute yourself.
Am I audible now?
Yeah.
Right. Yeah, it is a pleasant duty to convey our thanks to the speaker for being a part of this PR program. I thank you, sir, for this eloquent, exciting, illuminating, informative reaction describing the way in which the advancements of launch vehicle technology contributed to the growth of the Indian Space Organization over the past 5 decades. And your vivid description of various intricate issues that really, you know, helped convey the excitement that existed in the minds of one and all who were actually involved so deeply into it. And also especially the experience, the contribution to the cryogenic engines and sharing the excitement for the future programs and missions like small satellite launch vehicle, reusable launch vehicle, and orbital recovery. These are very exciting programs, and you put on your record what kind of things that you are doing in the near future. On behalf of all the PRL family, I thank you, Sri Swamnath Ji, for being a part of our 75 years of celebration. I would also like to thank the several dignitaries who have joined us through WebEx and YouTube. Just to name a few, Dr. Madhavan Nair, Dr. Jayaraman, Sita, Lalitambika Ji, Prakash Chauhan, Rajiv, Dr. Patra, and Sri Padmav Joshi, and others. And I'm sure, you know, there are, before we close the meeting, I would like to convey our best wishes to you for the success of tomorrow's launch. And you really conveyed your excitement through this medium. We thank you once again for that. And this brings close today's meeting. Take care and see you all in the next Vyakhyan. Thank you and bye-bye from PRL.
Thank you so much. Thank you for...